language, the language of doubt, and the language of defeat, and the language of depression will never be in my mouth again. If it's not in your mouth, it will not be in your mind. Don't express it, and you will not impress it upon yourself. Although they are falling by your side, you will stand. And then it says, not for the arrow that flieth by day, not for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, not for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. Then it says in verse 8, only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee. You go out, you'll come back safely. You travel, you'll come back safely. Anywhere you go, the angels of the Lord are following you. It says, see, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague. You know, HIV is a plague, it will not come near you. And tuberculosis is a common plague nowadays, it will not come near you. Ulcer is a plague, it will not come near your dwelling. And then cancer is a plague, it will never come near you. Brain tumor is a plague, it will never come near your dwelling. It says over here, neither shall any plague come out of that being, come near thy dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. Now we don't have time, but if you know the story of those angels, when the angel came against the army that wanted to destroy the people of God in Isaiah chapter 37, you can read it later, the angel came and destroyed 185,000 of those enemies. How many enemies do you have? Do you have up to 180,000? I said you have up to 185,000 enemies. Ah, if one angel can destroy all those enemies in one night, your enemies are finished. I pity anybody that says, you know, he's going to run after you. He doesn't have any other assignment to do. He looks at my dear sister here and says, you know, you, I'm going to run after you. When they say that, don't hide yourself inside your house. And don't say, those enemies are after me. Then come out. I said come out. And dress well. When I say dress well, I say dress in the armor of the Lord. Put on the whole armor of God. And take the shield of faith in your hand. And walk in front of them like this. They'll be looking at you like this. And then somebody will say, that's the person you were looking for. He said, I don't know what. When I saw her again, I cannot move anymore. And I cannot talk anymore. I cannot say anything anymore. Just looking at her makes me afraid. They'll be afraid of you. For he shall give his angels charge over them to keep you in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder. The young lion and the dragon shall not trample under your feet. They are under your feet. I said they are under your feet. Number two, the strength and the power of faith. The strength and the power of faith. You see, in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 16. Ephesians chapter 6, we're looking at verse 16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able. The shield of faith gives you ability. Able. Then ability. You are able, therefore you have ability. And it gives you strength, and it gives you power. In Joshua chapter 1, I'm reading to you from verse 5. Joshua chapter 1, verse 5. There shall not any man be able to stand before you. Well, if there's no magician, no sorcerer, no witch, no wizard, no fortune teller, and nobody like Balaam will be able to stand before you, then you have supernatural strength. You have supernatural power. And you have supernatural protection. There shall no man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. You know, some people say, I used to be strong. Don't say that again. The implication is, I'm not strong anymore. I used to be agile and active. Don't say that anymore. The implication is, you're no more agile and active. I used to be bold. Don't say that anymore. That means that you are not bold anymore. I know myself. I used to be courageous. Don't say that anymore, because the implication is, when you say, I used to be, it means that you are no more. But then it says, all the days of your life. All the days of your life. Ah, but you say, Pastor, to tell the truth and the reality, I am weak. How do you know you are weak? I feel weak. I'm not talking about your feeling, I'm talking about your faith. You don't live by feeling, you live by faith. What you express is what you impress. You see, when you say, I am weak, and you express it, you impress it upon yourself. When, for example, we're going to service on Sunday morning, and then maybe you are a preacher, or you are to handle the search, the scripture, and then early that morning, or maybe it was in the night, you felt like going to the toilet, and you were having runny stomach, and then you went to the toilet, you came back, after 1 hour, you woke up again and went to the toilet. And then you woke up in the morning, you remember, I am to handle such a scripture this morning. And then you say, be careful what you say. I said, be careful what you say. Because what you express is what you impress. Now, you are the one to control your stomach. Your stomach is not to control you. And your bowels, they are not to control you. You are the one to control your bowel by the word of faith. I am the teacher of such the scripture this morning. I am able, and nothing will hinder me. I about your stomach, that's feeling, that's feeling. That's what I'm feeling in my stomach. I'm not running my life on the basis of feeling. I'm running my life on the basis of faith. And I say that this morning, although the stomach is like that, then I overlook it, I neglect it, and I say, I will do what the Lord has called me to do. I am prepared. I've done the study. I've done everything I ought to do. And this will not hinder me. This morning I will teach. And this morning I will do good to the church. And this morning I will do everything well. And then your wife says, I saw the way you are, you know, going to a toilet in the night. Can I call the coordinator so that they'll choose another person? Be careful what you say. What you express is what you impress. If you say, my wife, I'm feeling weak. The moment you say that, if you check up your life, you feel weaker. It's like, you know, your joints are down. But if you say, no, don't call the coordinator, I am strong. I said I am strong. And I can stand. 30 minutes, 25 minutes to teach the scripture, I will teach. And nobody will know that anything happened in the night. And then you come. By the time you wake up and then you take your bath and you dress up, and then you say, I am going to teach this morning. I'm going to teach effectively this morning. I am strong this morning. I'm a child of God this morning. I'm the teacher in our local church this morning. What you express is what you impress. Your mind will pick it up. You will have the mind of Christ. And nothing shall be impossible unto you. Because you express it, you impress it, and then everybody will see. And then you come. And then you will not be thinking in your mind, this one that I'm trying. Are you trying or trusting? You see, your language, your vocabulary matters. This one I am trying to do. Am I sure that this one will carry me? If you are trying, it will not carry you. If you are trusting, the Lord will carry you. And so you see, it says here, as I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. The Lord will not fail you. And the Lord will not forsake you. You see how your amen is getting lower and lower. Praise the Lord. And you know, when the devil comes in the night and then he wants to threaten you, all of a sudden you'll hear my voice and then you'll hear the amen of these people. You know, the devil will be confused. Because when the devil hears my voice in your room, and then the devil hears a loud amen in your room, then you rise up, and then you say you want to attack the devil, to say you want to bind him. He is already terrified because of the amen. And then he has gone away in Jesus' name. You know, and those people in Jericho, they didn't know what to do. Because the people in Jericho, they were looking at the children of Israel. They were just moving around. And they said, what are these people doing? These Israelites coming away from Egypt. What are they doing, trying to do? And then all of a sudden, on the seventh day, after they went around seven times, and Joshua said, shout. Don't shout now. I've told you to shout. And Joshua said, shout. And they shouted. Those people in Jericho, they were totally confused. And when they shout, all the walls came down. All your walls are down already. Romans chapter 10. I'm reading from verse 17. Romans chapter 10. I'm reading from verse 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hearing by the word of God. That's how you build up yourself. Hearing the word of God every time. Jude, I'm reading from verse 20. Jude, verse 20. But ye beloved, building up yourselves in your most holy faith. Building up yourselves in your most holy faith. How do you build up yourself in your most holy faith? Many ways. The cases that have helped you to build up your faith. You listen to it many, many times, many days, many weeks, until the sin is inside you. Until you can even repeat it from the beginning to the end. Until it has formed part of your life. Building up yourself on your most holy faith. If you will do that, you will never be weak. In the work of the Lord, you'll be moving on, and you will succeed every time. In Joshua chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 6. Then the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb the son of Jephunneh the Kenizzite said unto him, thou knowest the saying that the Lord said unto Moses the man of God concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea. 40 years old was I when Moses the servant of the Lord sent me from Kadesh Barnea to espy out the land, and I brought him word again as it was in mine heart. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt, but I wholly followed the Lord my God. Don't borrow the confession of other people. Don't borrow the utterances of other people. Don't speak the language of other people. When the 12 spies came back from spying out the land of Canaan, they said, we be not able. That's what they expressed. That's what was impressed on them. There are giants in the land. That's what they expressed. That's what was impressed on them. And then they said, we are like grasshoppers in their sight. That's what they expressed, and that's what was impressed on them. But Caleb said, don't talk like that. We are well able. Do you see the story there? The people that said they were not able, they were not able. The people that said, only Joshua and Caleb, we are able. Those were the people that were able. Now, what was the difference between Joshua and Caleb and the rest of the ten? Because see, they went on the same road. They saw the same giants. And they climbed the same mountain. They saw the same fruit. And they came back the same way. Why did they have a difference in language? Because since they saw the same giants, seeing the giants, the ten became afraid. But seeing the giants, the two became courageous. What's the difference? Here is the difference. Look up here, please. In the middle here, we have the giants. And then over here on my left, we have the spies, 12 of them. On this other side, on my right, we have the Almighty God. When the 10 looked at the giants, they compared the giants with themselves. And therefore, they saw themselves as grasshoppers, and they saw the giants as big, unconquerable, irresistible, powerful. The two, they saw the giants, but they compared the giants with the Almighty God. And when they compared the giants with the Almighty God, then they saw that the giants were very small in comparison with God. When you see a problem, it depends on where you are making your comparison. If you are making the comparison with your natural strength, you will feel weak. If you are making the comparison with the strength of the Almighty God, then you know this is no problem. I said this is no problem. And this sickness, this is nothing. Compare it with God. Don't compare it with your natural strength. And then we have here Joshua. Joshua said, I only follow the Lord. He said, now behold in verse 10, the Lord has kept me alive. The Lord will keep you alive. As he said, these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now look, I am this day fourscore, that's 85 years old, as yet I am strong. Everybody say, I am strong. And you know, if you look at some preachers, and some of these preachers, they emphasize just what they know. And one of those preachers is Kenneth Hagin. He sent out